Hello students, this is Mrs. Janapati Cruz from Leelavati Lalji Dayal College of Commerce. And in today's class, students, we are going to study economics, chapter number 3A, demand analysis. So before starting with this interesting chapter, students, let me tell you all that the total weightage of this chapter is 12 marks with option and 8 marks without option. So let's begin with this interesting chapter. So let us first understand the meaning of demand, okay? So students, according to Benham, the demand for anything at a given price is the total amount of it which will be brought per unit of time at that price, okay? So in simple words, what is demand? Demand is nothing but it is the desire plus willingness to purchase plus the ability to pay, okay? When you have the desire plus you are willing to purchase and plus you are able to purchase, that time we can tell it is demand, okay? So demand is a relative concept, students, because it is related to time and place, okay? So here in students, the demand schedule, okay? Let's study what the demand schedule is trying to tell us. So it is a tabular representation of the functional relationship between price and quantity demanded for a particular commodity, okay? So here we have two types of demand schedule, students, individual demand schedule and market demand schedule. Now, what do we understand by the term individual demand schedule, students? So individual demand schedule is a quantity of a commodity demanded by a consumer at a given price during a given period of time, okay? So, you know, the information is expressed in a table of the individuals, okay? Whatever information the individual is having, it is expressed in the table, and that table is termed as individual demand schedule, okay? So, it is a quantity demanded by an individual consumer during a given period of time. Then we have the second one, that is the market demand schedule. So here at students, market demand is a total demand for the quantity, okay, for the commodity from all the consumers at a given price during a period of time. So basically, market means it is, you know, it takes into consideration the demand from all the consumers at a given period of time, okay? So this market demand schedule is in the tabular form, and that tabular form is termed as market demand schedule, okay? Now, let's move on to the first important answer of this chapter, and that is types of demand, okay? So the first type of demand, students, is direct demand, okay? So when the demand for goods which satisfy the wants directly, that demand is termed as direct demand, okay? When your wants are satisfied directly, it becomes your direct demand. Second, indirect demand, okay, it is also termed as derived demand, okay? So here in students, the demand for goods, okay, which are needed for further production, which is required for further production, like land, labor, capital, that can be termed as your indirect demand. Then you have complementary or joint demand. Now, what is complementary, students? When two or more goods, okay, are required to satisfy one want, okay? Two goods which are satisfying one want, that is termed as your complementary demand. Then you have composite demand, okay? So here in students, a demand for a product, okay, which can be put into several uses, that can be termed as your composite demand. Last one is competitive demand. So what is competitive demand, students? Demand for these goods, okay, which are substitute for each other. For example, you can say, if you know, you want to have a tea, so somebody tells you, is coffee fine? So yeah, coffee also will be fine. So this becomes a competitive demand. So demand for substitute goods can be termed as competitive demand. So herein we've completed 5 types of demand: direct, indirect, complementary, composite, and competitive demand. Let's move on to the next answer, students, and that talks about determinants of demand, okay? So to remember this answer, we have a code word, pine, salt, okay? Now, P, 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 okay? There are 3 P's, pine, and then you have S-A-L-T. So let's start, okay? The first determinant of demand is price, okay? So consumer, students, they purchase more at a lower price and vice versa. So demand for the goods will be more when the price is lesser. Then you have prices of substitute goods, okay? People always tend to demand for a substitute good which is available at a lower price. Then you have price of complementary goods, okay? So students, change in price, okay, of one commodity will help you to, you know, will differ the change in price of the other commodity as well, okay? The demand for other commodity will also change, that is price of complementary good. Then you have income, okay? So here it, students, when there is rise in income, that in turn will lead to rise in demand and vice versa. Then you have nature of product, okay? So demand for necessary product always remains the same irrespective of the changes in the prices. Then you have expectation about the future prices, okay? So when the consumer expects the price to fall, okay, in the near future, the demand for that commodity will tend to fall, okay? Next one, you have size of population, students. So larger the population, greater is the demand for the commodity. Next one is advertisement. So effective advertisement will lead to increase in demand. Next one, level of taxation. So lower tax rate increases the income level, which in turn will help you to increase the demand. The last one, students, is taste, habits, and fashion. So your students, the taste, the habits, the fashion, it influences the demand to a greater extent. For example, if the price of alcohol rise, okay, the consumption of the addicted person, okay, will also be the same, okay? It will not affect him because it has become the habit of that alcoholic person. So with this, students, we've completed the determinants of demand, and the code word is fine soil. So P cube stands for price, prices of substitute goods, prices of complementary goods, income, nature of product, expectations about future prices, size of population, advertisement, level of taxation, and in the end we have taste, habit, and fashion. Let us move on to the next slide, students, and that talks about law of demand, okay? So very important answer, student, we need to understand this very nicely. So what is the law of demand saying, okay? So here, for students, the law of demand was introduced by Professor Alfred Marshall in his book, Principles of Economics, which was published in the year 1890, okay? The law explains the functional relationship between the price and the quantity demanded, okay? So what is the law saying? Let us see and have a look on the law. Other things being equal, okay? Higher the price of the commodity, smaller is the quantity demanded, and lower the price of the commodity, larger is the quantity demanded. That means if the price rises, the demand, you know, decreases. If the price falls, the demand increases, okay? Let us now study, students, the assumptions of the law of demand, okay? So the first assumption is constant level of income, okay? So here, if, you know, if the income will rise, the demand will also rise. Next one, no change in size of population. So increased population will in turn lead to increase in demand, hence there should be no change in size of population. Then you have prices of substitute goods remains the same. So here, to avoid the changes in demand for the commodity, the prices of substitute goods will also remain the same. Next, you have prices of complementary goods remain constant, okay? So if there is a change, okay, in the price of the complementary good, it will affect the demand for the commodity too. Next one, no expectation about future changes in price. So students, people will purchase less if they expect the price to fall in the near future. So there should be no expectations about the future changes in price. Next one, students, is no changes in taste, habit, and preference, okay? So this leads to a direct change in demand. For example, you can say clothing trend. So you're in, if the trend for the clothes changes, this will have a direct effect on demand. Last one is no change in taxation policy. So as this will affect, students, the income level of an individual, and this in turn, okay, will change the quantity of demand. So with this, students, we've completed assumptions. Now let us see this diagram. We have the price of the commodity and the quantity demanded. So if you want to understand the law of demand, we can understand this by this table. So if the price, when the price was 50, you purchased 1 kg. When it became 40, you purchased 2, and consequently when it became 10, you purchased 5 kgs. Okay, so here in, students, what can we see? When the price of the commodity decreases, the demand for the commodity increases. Okay, again in the demand curve, we can see on the x-axis you have the quantity demanded, and on the y-axis you have the price of the commodity. As the price, okay, you can see the quantity is, you know, when the price of the commodity increases, okay, the demand for that quantity falls. So you can see a downward slope in the demand curve. Now, there are certain exceptions, students, to this law. So let's understand, and the code word here is G-SHIP, okay? G stands for Giffen's paradox, okay? So it refers to inferior goods. Now, what are inferior goods? Substandard goods, okay? So inferior goods demand is low, even if the price for the product is low. So even if the price falls, but people will not demand inferior good, okay? So this Giffen's paradox was explained by Sir Robert Giffen. Next one, students, is speculation, okay? Now, what is speculation? People often purchase more, okay, when the price rises. What do they assume? That further, again, there will be a rise in the near future. So they speculate the rise in price in the future and they start purchasing more. Next one is habitual goods, students. So due to addiction, okay, or habitual nature, people always purchase the product no matter the price rises or fall. For example, tea. If first tea was 5 rupees per cup, now it has become 10, but still people are consuming it because they are habitual. Next, you have ignorance. Okay, so ignoring the prevailing current price and price change, people often purchase more at a higher price. Okay, there is a concept of ignorance among them. Next, you have prestige goods. So students, goods, okay, that are in demand are always quoted at a higher price. Okay, so these prestige goods are always in demand even at a higher price. Last one is price illusion. So branded products, students, are always in high demand even at a higher price, okay, because of the illusion that expensive products are always good. So that is why they always have a higher demand, okay? So with this, we've completed exceptions to the law, and the code word G-SHIP. G stands for Giffen's paradox, S speculation, H habitual goods, I ignorance, P prestige goods, and the last one is price illusion, okay? Now, the next topic, students, is, you know, the variation in demand, okay? So what is variation in demand? Variation in demand depends upon the price, okay? It leads to changes, and because of the changes in price, we have expansion or contraction of demand. And next one is changes in demand. It depends on the other factors, which in turn leads to increase or decrease in demand. Okay. So herein you can see the expansion in demand. Okay. The quantity demanded and the price. Okay. When the price rises, the quantity demanded falls. Okay, so this is the, you can see when the quantity demanded, okay, when the quantity demanded is there on the x-axis and y-axis, you have price. So the when the price rises, the quantity demanded always falls. Okay, again, we have the contraction of demand. The demand becomes less, it becomes contracted. Again, we have a downward slope into it. Okay, so what is contraction of demand, students? It refers to fall in demand due to rise in the price alone. So when the price rises, the demand falls. So you can see a downward slope in the contraction of demand. Then we have decrease in demand. So it refers to decrease in the quantity demanded due to unfavorable changes in other factors. So your students, the price is constant, but because of unfavorable conditions, unfavorable factors, the demand of the quantity falls. Okay, so with this, students, we've completed the chapter, demand analysis. Thank you.